Bhadreshu
Anandayesu Bhadreshu
Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya Bhagavati Uttama Shloke
Bhagavati Uttama Shloke
Bhakti Bhavati Naishtiki
Bhakti Bhavati Naishtiki
We're reading Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 2, Chapter Number 3, Pure Devotional Service, Text Number 16. Vayasakhi,
Cha,
Bhagavan,
Vasudeva,
Parayana, Guru Gaya. Cha, also, Bhagavan, full in transcendental knowledge.
Full in transcendental knowledge.
Vasudeva.
Vasudeva.
Lord Krishna.
Lord Krishna.
Parayana.
Parayana.
Attached to.
Attached to.
Guru Gaya.
Guru Gaya.
Of the personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna, who is glorified by great philosophers.
Of the personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna, who is glorified by great philosophers.
Guna Udara.
Guna Udara.
Great qualities.
Great qualities.
Satam.
Satam.
Of the devotees.
Of the devotees.
Swaraj must have been.
Must have been.
He in a matter.
In a matter.
In a matter of fact.
In a matter of fact.
Samagane.
Samagane.
By the presence of.
By the presence of.
Translation. Sukadeva Goswami, the son of Vyasadeva, was also full in transcendental knowledge and was a great devotee of Lord Krishna, son of Vasudeva. So there must have been discussion of Lord Krishna, who is glorified by great philosophers and in the company of great devotees. The word satam is very important in this verse. Satam means the pure devotees who have no other desire than to serve the Lord. Only in the association of such devotees are the transcendental glories of Lord Krishna properly discussed. It is said by the Lord that his topics are all full of spiritual significance, and once one properly hears about him in the association of this satam, certainly one senses the great potency and so automatically attains to the devotional stage of life. As already described, Maharaj Parikshit was a great devotee of the Lord from his very birth, and so was Sukadeva Goswami. Both of them were on the same level, although it appears that Maharaj Parikshit was a great king accustomed to royal facilities, whereas Sukadeva Goswami was a typical renouncer of the world, so much so that he did not even put a cloth on his body. Superficially, Maharaj Parikshit and Sukadeva Goswami might seem to be opposites, but basically they were both unalloyed pure devotees of the Lord. When such devotees are assembled together, there can be no topic save discussions of the glories of the Lord or Bhakti Yoga. In the Bhagavad Gita, also, when there were talks between the Lord and his devotee Arjuna, there could not be any topic other than Bhakti Yoga. However, the mundane scholars may speculate on it in their own ways. The use of the word cha after Vaishasiki suggests, according to Srila Jiva Goswami, that both Sukadeva Goswami and Maharaj Parikshit were of the same category, settled long before, although one was playing the part of the master and the other the disciple. Since Lord Krishna Krishna is the center of the topic, the word Vasudeva Parayanaha, or devotee of Lord Vasudeva, suggests devotee of Lord Krishna, the common name. Although there were many others who assembled at the place where Maharaj Pariksit was fasting, the natural conclusion is that there was no topic other than the glorification of Lord Krishna, because the principal speaker was Sukadeva Goswami and the chief audience was Maharaj Pariksit. So Srimad Bhagavatam, as it was spoken and heard by two principal devotees of the Lord, is only for the glorification of the Supreme Lord, the personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna. Om Jnana Dhanam Dasya Khyanam Jana Shalakaya Chatur Mikandina Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Vancha Kampadaram Yashya Kripa Sindhu Vahe Vacha Patitanam Pavanevyo Vaishnavibhyo Namo Namaha Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Rishi is asking Sutta Goswami about what happened when Sukadeva Goswami met with Maharaj Pariksit. He wants to understand fully the situation, how these two people met, because they're so different. As described, Sukadeva Goswami, he is abadut. He's totally detached from the material world. He doesn't identify with any of the ashrams. He didn't even wait for the father to put the sacred bread around him. Immediately he left home. So he was totally detached from the world and wandering even without clothing. He appeared like a madman. When you see somebody like that wandering naked, you think he must be crazy. So people thought, Sukadeva, even 5,000 years ago, somebody's walking around naked, they thought it's a bit crazy. So the children, other children, they saw Sukadeva Goswami, who was a young man, they thought, not he must be insane. And they were throwing things at him even and making fool of him. But Sukadeva Goswami was completely fixed on a transcendental platform. He was a greatly realized soul. He had heard the Srimad Bhagavatam while he was in the womb of his mother. And he'd been in the womb for, he stayed in the womb, for 16 years. He didn't like to come out. But he was convinced to come out because the Lord came there and told him, don't worry, that you'll be saved. He was thinking, if I come out, there's so much maya, there's so much temptations of the material world, that it's safer for me to just stay here in the womb. But Lord Krishna came there and told him, no, if you come out, you'll be Srimad Bhagavatam, so you can be fixed in transcendental knowledge. So Sukadeva Goswami came out and immediately left home. And Vyasadeva was chasing after him, because Vyasadeva wanted, he said, at least take this thread, let me give you initiation, let me initiate you as a Brahmana, put the sacred thread on him. But Sukadeva Goswami didn't worry about that. So you see, in the line of Shankaracharya, those people who have renounced the world, they don't wear sacred threads. They don't wear the Brahmanical thread, the upavitra. They take that off because that's a material designation. You wear the sacred thread, you're designating yourself as a Brahmana. So Brahman Kshatriya Vaishya Sutra, that's Varnashram Dharma. It's a material designation. And similarly, of course, Mayavadi sannyasis, they don't wear sacred thread. So Lord Chaitanya didn't wear sacred thread. Because Lord Chaitanya took sannyas and took off the thread. And the designation of the Brahmana is material. Of course, when we worship the deity, when we do the deity worship, we also say there's a prayer which we should recite before we offer the arti, before we go to worship the deity, and we pray to the Lord that I am not a Brahmin, I am not a Kshatriya, I am not a Vaishya, I am not a Sudra. And I am not a sannyasi or a vanaprastha or a grihastha or a brahmachari. But I am simply the servant of the servant of the servant of that one Supreme Lord who is loved by the gopis. So that is a prayer for purifying our consciousness before we go on the altar. We think like that, that I don't belong to any of the varnas or the ashrams. My designation is simply a servant of the servant of the servant of the Supreme Lord who is loved by the gopis of Vrindavan. So Sukadeva Goswami, he was in that consciousness. He was a liberating soul from birth. He was Atmarama. Atmarama means one who takes pleasure in the self. Atmarama, taking pleasure in Atma, the self. So one who is Atmarama, he takes pleasure in the self. He doesn't take pleasure from the material world. He doesn't take pleasure in eating and sleeping. He doesn't take pleasure in dressing in nice clothes and so on. That's all material. But he takes pleasure within himself. And those who are Atmarama, they're absorbed in transcendental consciousness. Of course, there's a famous verse in the Srimad Bhagavatam, which is called the Atmarama Shloka. And this is often bewildering to the impersonalists. And therefore, Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya asked Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to explain it. And then also Sanatana Goswami also asked Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to explain the Atmarama Shloka. Because it's hard for the impersonalists to understand. Atmaramascha munayo nirgranta apirukrame kurvanti ahaitakim bhakti itam bhuta unohari. So this verse describes that even those who are Atmarama, who are liberated souls, they will take pleasure in hearing about Krishna, hearing the topics of Krishna. Now sometimes people will say, oh, the topics of Krishna. Krishna are just about a lusting young boy and his affairs with the young girls in Vrindavan, and they think of it as to be something mundane. They don't understand that these affairs of the Lord are all transcendental. Lord Krishna's pastimes with the gopis are not material, but rather they're performed on the highest transcendental platform. And that is why people like Sukadeva Goswami even take pleasure in hearing these things and in describing these things. If these things, if these pastimes of Lord Krishna were ordinary, then a personality like Sukadeva Goswami would never be interested in them. But because they are completely pure and transcendental, therefore Sukadeva Goswami is attracted to them, and he likes to describe them. And he did. He described the pastimes of Lord Krishna to Maharaj Parikshit. So as we described yesterday, Maharaj Parikshit is from a devotee family, coming from the family of the Pandavas. He's the grandson of Arjuna. So he's naturally a devotee. The Pandavas are all great devotees of Lord Krishna. And their grandson, Maharaj Parikshit, was also a great devotee. And Sukadeva Goswami is the son of Vyasadeva. And Vyasadeva is also a devotee. And Vyasadeva has glorified Lord Krishna in the Srimad Bhagavatam. So Sukadeva Goswami was also a devotee from his birth. But the two are very different, because Maharaj Parikshit was the emperor of the world. He's ruling the great kingdom. So he had lived in the palace, and he had a lot of royal facilities suitable for the monarch. And Sukadeva Goswami is completely renounced. He's not at all interested in the material world. In fact, it's described how he was leaving home, and his father was chasing after him. And at one point, Sukadeva Goswami was walking along, and he came past a lake where young ladies were bathing in the water. And the young ladies were bathing there naked. But when Sukadeva Goswami came there, they were not worried, because they could understand the transcendental position of Sukadeva Goswami. They saw that he was not interested in them. So they didn't worry, they just kept on bathing. Sukadeva Goswami went past. But then Srila Vyasadeva came there, and Srila Vyasadeva, he's of course much older, he's the father of Sukadeva Goswami. So he came past. And when Vyasadeva came past, then the young ladies were all worried, and they all rushed to cover their bodies. So Vyasadeva was puzzled by this, and he inquired from them, and he said, "Look, why are you worried about me? I'm an old man. You don't have to be worried about me. You didn't worry about my son. He was a young man. Why are you worried about me?" But the girls said, the young ladies, they said to Srila Vyasadeva, they said, "Yes, but we see that he is not of the material world, but you are of the material world. You're in the world, but he's not of this world." So this was the position of Sukadeva Goswami, that he's such an exalted soul that he's even greater than his father, Srila Vyasadeva. So Srila Sukadeva Goswami is one of the Mahajans, one of the 12 Mahajans, the authorities on devotional service. And he had heard all about devotional service from his own father, Srila Vyasadeva. and he is totally detached from the world, but still it was arranged by the will of the Supreme Lord, or by the will of Providence, we could say. It arranged that Sukadeva Goswami would come to the place where Maharaj Parikshit is preparing for death. Maharaj Parikshit, when he was cursed, he left everything. He just put aside everything. He took off all of his ornaments and all the fine clothes. He found some simple cloth and he went off to look for some people to guide him, to help him to prepare for leaving the body. It shows us how intelligent he was, that he understood that at this point in my life, I need to get good association. He understood that association is of prime importance. At any time, association is important. But especially towards the end of life, we want to get the best association to guide us and to keep us in good consciousness. So Maharaj Parikshit had gone to look for people, and he found many great sages on the bank of the Ganga, or the Yamuna actually. But it's customary where the holy rivers are, that there will be saintly people residing there because they like to take their bath in the holy rivers. So Sukadeva Goswami came there and he was inquiring from them how he should prepare for leaving the world. And the different sages had different suggestions. Different people, some were saying, you know, oh, we will do a yajna for you, we'll do a yajna for you. You, and some were saying, you know, just simply don't do anything, just simply stop all activities and just sit and do nothing, go into trance. And some were saying, do different kinds of charity and austerities. People have different opinions. But then it happened that Sukadeva Goswami appeared. And with the appearance of Sukadeva Goswami, all the other sages, they knew that, oh, this is Vyasadeva coming. He's the son of Srila Vyasadeva. So let him say what should be done. And this was very much appreciated by Maharaj Parikshit, because Maharaj Parikshit knew that this son of Vyasadeva will be a devotee of Lord Krishna. And he wanted to hear about Krishna, because that was the mood of his family. And so he thought, this is appropriate. I want to hear about Krishna from him. And so the two met together, and the Srimad Bhagavatam was spoken. Now the Srimad Bhagavatam was spoken in different places by different people. It had been spoken by the Lord to Brahma at the beginning of the creation. There's a Chatur-Sloki Bhagavatam, the Bhagavatam in four verses. So at the beginning of the creation, the Lord instructed Lord Brahma in the four verses of the Srimad Bhagavatam. And then Lord Brahma, he of course is the father of people like Narada Muni. So Narada Muni, he heard the Srimad Bhagavatam from his father. And then Narada Muni is the guru of Vyasadeva. So Srila Vyasadeva, he heard Srimad Bhagavatam from Narada Muni. And in this way, Srila Vyasadeva was writing, and he was writing the Puranas, he was writing supplements to the Vedas. Vedas speak more about karma kanda activities. So in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna said, Trigunya Vishaya Veda, Nais Trigunya Bhavarjuna, that the Vedas deal with the subject matter of the three modes of material nature. Rise above the modes and be transcendental to everything, Krishna is saying to Arjuna. So it's very difficult to know Krishna from the Vedas. So Srila Vyasadeva compiled the Puranas, which are supplements to the Vedas. And he compiled 18 Puranas, and there were 6 Puranas for each of the three modes. 6 Puranas for the mode of ignorance, 6 Puranas for the mode of passion, and 6 Puranas for the mode of goodness. But after Srila Vyasadeva had written all his books, he also wrote Mahabharata, which is a very big book that many thousands, hundreds of thousands, 100,000 more slokas. And he still was not feeling any satisfaction. He still felt something was lacking. And it was at that time that Narada Muni came to him. And Narada Muni told him, the reason why you're not satisfied is because you have not properly glorified the Supreme Lord. That you have to properly glorify Lord Shri Krishna. And without glorification of Lord Krishna, you'll never feel satisfaction, even though you write volumes of books. And that you've missed the whole point. The whole purpose of all knowledge is to surrender to Krishna. So Narada Muni chastised Vyasadeva that you misdirected people, you encourage people in the path of fruit. Not encourage them in devotional service. This is what's missing. And so Sukadeva Goswami, he understood all this, and he is met now, Maharaj Parikshit, and so he's going to speak this Srimad Bhagavatam to Maharaj Parikshit. The Srimad Bhagavatam goes on from where the Bhagavad Gita stops. Right? The Bhagavad Gita stops where Krishna said, surrender to me. Give up all material religion and just surrender to me. I will free you from all sinful reactions. Do not fear. So that's the end of the Bhagavad Gita. And then Srimad Bhagavatam begins. Now you've surrendered to Krishna. What is your duty? What should you do? So the Bhagavatam is described that Dharma Prajita Kaitava Chaparamo Nirmataranam Satam. That give up all cheating religion. Cheating religion, Dharma Kaitava, Kaitava Dharma. Means cheating religion, and cheating religion is karmakandi kind of religion. If you do religion for material purposes, then that is cheating. Because you go to the God and you worship the Lord, but your purpose is to get. You didn't come just to give. You didn't come to take shelter or surrender. You came to get something. You came to get to do some business, to get something from the Lord. So that karmakandi consciousness, that is not encouraged in Srimad Bhagavatam. It's rejected from the beginning. And the Srimad Bhagavatam is for those who have given up envy. Because in the material world, everyone is envious of others. Oh, we envy this one. Oh, they've got... He's got a nicer wife than my wife. Oh, this one, he's got more children than I've got. Oh, he's got more money than I've got. This is the business of the material world, is envy. We look at others and we're bitter that, he's got more enjoyment than I've got. Why he should get this? Why I don't have that? So this envy is the business of the material world. But Srimad Bhagavatam is for people who have stopped being envious. The Nirmatsaranam Satam. They've given up envy. They're not thinking of what others have got. They're only thinking about their own purpose in life. What is my business here? What should I do? They can understand that just simply getting material facilities and material enjoyment is not the goal of life. That there's much more to life than that. So, Srimad Bhagavatam directs us, it awakens us to the higher consciousness, to understand what is our duty in this world. So we have to hear the Srimad Bhagavatam from the pure devotee, like Sukadeva Goswami. Because Sukadeva Goswami was empowered, he's the representative of Vyasadeva, he's the son. And he is completely renounced, he's detached from the world. So he can speak the Srimad Bhagavatam, he can impress it on the audience. Because he's showing it the example of renunciation and detachment himself. Just like Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was glorified by Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya. After Lord Chaitanya explained the Atmarama Sloka to Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, then Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya understood the identity of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and at that time he wrote a number of verses glorifying Lord Chaitanya. So one of the verses is especially very beautiful. It says, Vairagya Vidya Vija Bhakti Yoga Shikshakta Eka Purusha Purana Shri Krishna Chaitanya Sharera Dari Kripambudir Yastvam Aham Prapadye. He's offering his obeisances to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, describing him as being an ocean of mercy, that he has come to teach us this process of devotional service, which is based on vairagya, detachment, and vidya, transcendental knowledge. So these two things, they are actually following. Wherever there is real bhakti, there will be vairagya, detachment from the world, and vidya, actual transcendental knowledge. So Sukadeva Goswami was enriched not only with transcendental knowledge, but also with vairagya, and not just with vairagya, but also with transcendental knowledge. We see some people are renounced, but they have no knowledge. Some people have knowledge, but not very renounced. But Sukadeva Goswami had both these qualities. He was both fixed in renunciation, and he was also full in transcendental knowledge. So he could deliver the message of Srimad Bhagavatam to Maharaj Parikshit. Now Maharaj Parikshit, he's also a great devotee. He could have been speaking himself. He knows everything, but he wants to hear it. It's the business of devotees when they come together to discuss. Just like it's described about the prayers, in the prayers by the personified Vedas, there was a question raised by Maharaj Parikshit. This question was, how is it transcendence can be put into words? The Brahman is pure and spiritual. How could it ever be described by words? Because words are material. So how could transcendence ever be described by words? And so it's narrated how this same question was raised previously on Janaloka. Janaloka is one of the upper planets in the universe. Above Swargaloka, there's four other planets. There's Mahaloka, Janaloka, Tapaloka, and Satyaloka. And those four planets are, they're not annihilated until the end of the life of Brahma. So in Janaloka, the four Kumaras reside, they were there, and there was a discussion with the great sages there, the same question about how could transcendence be described in words. And so it's described that, all the sages there, they knew the answer, but one was chosen to speak. They asked Sanandana Kumar, the four Kumaras, they're all enlightened and transcendental knowledge, but one of them was chosen to speak. Sanandan Kumar, he spoke. Why? Because it's a business of devotees when they come together to discuss and to share transcendental knowledge. Machita Madhita Prana Bodhayanta Paraspara. Yes? You have to learn these slogans. Katayam kasya mamnityam dushyantita aramadhita. The thoughts of my pure devotees dwell in me. Their lives are surrendered unto me, and they derive great satisfaction and bliss, enlightening one another and conversing about me. Chapter 10, sloka number 11. Or sloka number 10. Oh, 9. Sloka 9. This is the chapter Sloki Bhagavad Gita. There are four verses there. And so this is one of them. Tushanti cha, ramanti cha. They like, they take pleasure in discussing topics of Krishna together, just like we're doing in our temples everywhere. Every day we sit and we discuss. It's for our pleasure. And also the deities also take pleasure to hear. Alright, any questions?
While chanting, how to concentrate more on chanting? Like when we chant, I feel like my mind is keep on wandering all over the place, not properly concentrating on chanting.
Chant louder.
Chant louder.
Where are you chanting? You have to chant where you're not going to get distracted. You have to want to focus your attention. Sometimes we say, if you sit in front of a computer and try to chant, then it will be difficult. Some people said they have handed a big bag of mobile phone in the other hand. You can't chant like that. You have to want to chant with attention. So desire to chant with full attention. And then you, Krishna will give you the intelligence. Sometimes Bhaktivinoda Thakur would put a blanket over his head, chant under the blanket, so it's not really strength. Pray to Krishna.